There's a place for us, somewhere a place for us, peace and quiet and open air. Wait for us somewhere. There's a time for us, someday a time for us, time together. There's a place for us, a time and place for us. Hold my hand and we're halfway there. Hold my hand and I'll take you there.
Well, welcome everyone and good morning. This is the Namaqua Unitarian Universalist Congregation, and I hope it's a place for you. My name is Laurel Liefert, and I serve as the minister of this warm, welcoming, justice-seeking community. And today we come together to celebrate National Coming Out Day. Whoever you are, wherever you're from, whatever you do, whomever you love, you are welcome here. And whether you come today with joy in your heart or tears, you are welcome. All of you are welcome. As Unitarian Universalists, we know that each person has worth and dignity. And that worth includes our gender and our sexuality. And on this day, I'm proud to say that as a Unitarian Universalist, we open our doors to people of all sexual orientations and gender identities. And in fact, we value the diversity of sexuality and gender and see it as a spiritual gift. So our commitment is to create an inclusive community and to work for LGBTQ justice and equity as a core part of who we are. All of who you are is sacred, and all of who you are is welcome. I wanted to remind you the vote and tell them that Ruth sent you. And I don't know how many of you may have gotten your ballots, but I got mine in the mail yesterday. So definitely vote. And we're now starting, I think it's our 8th month of virtual services like this. And so all of our Sunday services are being recorded and posted on the Namaqua website. And Sarah Suriani, who is once again our Zoomer today, will keep your microphones muted unless you are otherwise instructed. And I know that we have one visitor because Doug and I were chatting with Tiffany before the service. If we have other visitors, I want to give you a specially warm welcome and tell you that my virtual door is open to you if you'd like to find out more about me and the congregation, and I'd love to get to know you better. And also we have a monthly newsletter and weekly emails that go out to the congregation. So if you'd like to be attuned to our weekly and monthly rhythm, why don't you put in the chat box your contact information and we'll add you to our list. And so now with no further ado, Doug Stewart, who is our worship associate today, and I will read the words to the chalice lighting and then I'll light our chalice.
May this flame we light remind us that every one of us can bring the light of love to the world.
May this clear flame be a symbol that every heart can burn bright with joy, peace, and harmony.
May the spirit of the ages speak to us through the flame of our time together and stay with us.
Every one of us can be a blessing to the world. And now, if you'll recite with me what we do every Sunday, our congregational affirmation, the words are on your screen. Love is the spirit of this church and service its call. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
Now let's clap together. That's it. This little light of mine,
I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
All right, keep clapping now. Sounds good. Everywhere I go.
Everywhere I go. I'm gonna let it shine.
Yes,
everywhere I go. I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine.
Oh, that sounds so good. That's called clapping on the backbeat. All right, sing this real quiet with me now.
Even when I'm afraid, I'm gonna let it shine. Even when I'm afraid, I'm gonna let it shine.
Yes, even when I'm afraid, I'm gonna let it shine.
Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Now our time for all ages. It's a story some of you may be familiar with called I Am Jazz, read by Jazz.
Hello, this is Jazz Jennings, and I am going to do a reading of my book, I Am Jazz. I am jazz. For as long as I can remember, my favorite color has been pink. My second favorite color is silver, and my third favorite color is green. Here are some of my other favorite things: dancing, singing, backflips, drawing, soccer, swimming, makeup, and pretending I'm a pop star. Most of all, I love mermaids. Sometimes I even wear a mermaid tail in the pool. My best friends are Samantha and Casey. We always have fun together. We like high heels and princess gowns, or cartwheels and trampolines. But I'm not exactly like Samantha and Casey. I have a girl brain, but a boy body. This is called transgender. I was born this way. When I was very little, and my mom would say, "You're such a good boy," I would say, "No, mama, good girl." At first, my family was confused. They'd always thought of me as a boy. As I got a little older, I hardly ever played with trucks or tools or superheroes, only princesses and mermaid costumes. My brothers told me this was girl stuff. I kept right on playing. My sister says I was always talking to her about my girl thoughts and my girl dreams and how one day I would be a beautiful lady. She would giggle and say, "You're a funny kid." Sometimes my parents let me wear my sister's dresses around the house, but whenever we went out, I had to put on my boy clothes again. This made me mad. Still, I never gave up trying to convince them. Pretending I was a boy felt like telling a lie. Then, one amazing day, everything changed. Mom and Dad took me to meet a new doctor who asked me lots and lots of questions. Afterward, the doctor spoke to my parents, and I heard the word transgender for the very first time. That night at bedtime, my parents both hugged me and said, "We understand now. Be who you are. We love you no matter what." This made me smile and smile and smile. Mom and Dad told me I could start wearing girl clothes to school and growing my hair long. They even let me change my name to Jazz. Being Jazz felt much more like being me. Mom said that being Jazz would make me different from the other kids at school, but that being different is okay. What's important, she said, is that I'm happy with who I am. Being Jazz caused some other people to be confused too, like the teachers at school. At the beginning of the year, they wanted me to use the boys' bathroom and play on the boys' team in gym class, but that didn't feel normal to me at all. I was so happy when the teachers changed their minds. I can't imagine not playing on the same team as Casey and Samantha. Even today, there are kids who tease me, or call me by a boy name, or ignore me altogether. This makes me feel crummy. Then, I remember that the kids who get to know me usually want to be my friend. They say I'm one of the nicest girls at school. I don't mind being different. Different is special. I think what matters most is what a person is like inside. And inside, I am happy. I am having fun. I am proud. I am Jazz. To all of the kids out there who are hearing this book for the first time, I just want to say that you can be like Jazz. You could be your true self. I know that it's hard living in this world and that sometimes people just don't understand, but if you just stay strong and keep moving forward and just stay true to who you are no matter what, then one day things will get better and you will be able to live your life as your true and authentic self. So always love yourself and always spread that love to the world around you because you are beautiful no matter what.
Great message. And you are beautiful and you deserve love. And one of the ways that we continue each week to weave what I call our tapestry of love we call community is to share our joys and sorrows. And so today let's go ahead and do it where if you want to speak, you can either put your joy or sorrow in the chat box or put your name there and I'll call on you. And if you can help me if you see someone with their hand raised, let me know so that I may not see everybody who's here today. So who would like to share a personal joy or sorrow and let us know what's going on in your life? Well, I have a joy, which is that yesterday afternoon, I was able to actually physically go into our sanctuary and marry a couple who've been together for 4 years, two brides, and it was just really a beautiful, beautiful honor. First of all, to be back in our sanctuary and also then to be with, it's Drew and Kim. So I was hoping they might be here today, but I don't see them so far. Blessings on their marriage. And I'll call on Kathy. You want to talk? Kathy Hartman.
I would tell you that I wasn't in church the day after my wedding, so I think that was a pretty high. So my mom was diagnosed with COVID. She spent, she's 93. She spent a brief time in the hospital and then they moved her back to the nursing home. There's a huge spike of coronavirus in Wisconsin and especially in her nursing home. So she's doing better. She was dehydrated and malnourished because she's been refusing food and water and everything else. So just keep her in your thoughts. It's hard to know where she's at mentally right now and what she would like those thoughts to be. Thanks.
Thank you, Kathy. And Jess Milden? Go ahead and unmute.
There we go. Took me a minute. So my father, it's been a long drawn out. He was sick since March and he lived with us for 6 months and was placed on hospice and we got him home to Iowa. And since he got home to Iowa, he's just been doing better and better and better. And he called me two nights ago and he said, well, they've kicked me out of hospice. I'm too healthy. So that's excellent news.
That's great. Well, I'm going to do our tradition of transferring a pebble from one bowl into our special community bowl. So I'll do one for Kathy, and I did one for you, Jess. And I think, Janet, I'll call you on in a second, but Janet, you have something to share?
Yes, I just got through with our second Sunday circle with our kids. And I just want to say that we have some awesome, awesome kids in our congregation. And Carol and Dick came and were our special guest speakers and did such a wonderful job. So I'm very grateful to them.
That's great. So it's the second Sunday of every month. Jan and our director of religious education from 9:30 to 9:50 has a gathering of the kids of our congregation and their families, and everyone is welcome. And Carol and Dick Barton, charter members, I understand that you told a little bit about how Namaqua was started. So thank you for that. And actually next month, I'm gonna be the guest speaker. So thanks, Janet, for keeping our kids and families together. And Janet Gillette, I think you have your, want to share something?
Yeah, two things. Technically, tomorrow is the 70th anniversary of this incarnation, but I am not celebrating my birthday until I can go to New Orleans. So it's going to be probably next summer before I decide that I'm 70 years old.
Oh, so, is that how it works?
Hmm. Yeah, that's the way it works because 2020 didn't happen. I'm in denial. Denial is not just a river. It's a place to live, and that's where I am. So speaking of which, my ex-husband, the father of my children, did pass away last Sunday evening. And my eldest daughter went out there to help her stepmother make the arrangements for the funeral. It's going to be next Thursday. But I have been disinvited. So it goes against everything my family stands for.
Sorry.
But, oh well, I don't need to spend the money to go out there anyway, so there. So, you know, good and bad and good and bad, and I'm hanging in there. I had a great job interview this week, and I'm hoping to get an offer this coming week with CSU. So everybody, for that, things could be looking up.
May it be so.
Thank you.
Let's see, who else? Pedro?
Yeah, I have one of each, you know, kind of reminding us that life has its ups and downs. I am still looking for work. I'm still unemployed, and that's kind of rough. But yesterday I went out with a bunch of volunteers to do some field work, and it was a beautiful day. And I had some great volunteers. We got a lot of stuff done. Everybody had a fun and a good time. And, you know, like I said, it's a reminder that everybody has their ups and downs. And even though I might be having a hard time, it's also some high points as well. So.
Thank you, Pedro. And I see Marsha Lewis from Pueblo, right?
Yes.
Another member.
Yeah, I have a bit of a sorrow. I had a flight to go visit my mother, my 97-year-old mother, this week. And Colorado, unfortunately, last week made it on the list of quarantines required in New York State, so I cannot go.
Oh, I'm sorry.
But she's doing well.
97, ooh la la. And I'm reading in the chat that Karen and Steve Dornsife celebrated their 39th anniversary yesterday. So they celebrated by hiking and seeing some bright mountain bluebird birds, and our pastoral care team is right on it and sent them a happy anniversary card. So happy anniversary to Steve and Karen. Oh. Is there anybody else? Well, I know that there are joys and sorrows probably that are in the silent sanctuary of your hearts. And so I'll put another couple of pebbles in to represent that. And as always, back on my table, my altar, I have two candles that are lit to represent the joys and sorrows of the world. And you see our rainbow flag and transgender flag back there as well. I read in UU World, which is the magazine that you get when you join a congregation, a really sweet way to end joys and sorrows. It was shared by Liz James in an article called How Do Unitarian Universalists Mourn? And by the way, Kathy Hartman, she's the one who runs the UU Hysterical Society, near and dear to your heart. But she describes how her home congregation in Saskatoon on the Canadian prairie ends joys and sorrows. And so I would like to try that today. What the worship leader today, me, says is in our joy and sorrow, and then you, the people, will say, we are not alone. So let's try that. In our joy and our sorrow, we are not alone. Now Doug Stewart will share his reflection.
When I first moved into my dorm room at college, I had just turned 18, my first home away from home. Moving in, I met my new roommates and also Joe in the next dorm room just down the hall. My coming out story is really Joe's coming out story. He won't mind my sharing it. Joe had an infectious laugh and just glowed with positivity towards life. That first day on campus, he'd met two girls in the bookstore, Leslie and Lori, and he invited me to join them in exploring the campus together. As it would turn out, the four of us would travel through school together and keeping in touch in waxing and waning ways all our lives. Our gang of four would eat in the cafeteria together or go to movies on the weekends and just generally hang out. When Joe's roommate left school after just a week or two, I de-tripled from my original crowded room and moved into room with Joe. And that began 3 years of our being comfortable roommates, shooting the breeze, solving life's problems, and Joe good-naturedly putting up with the unfolded clean laundry on my bed, while his bed was always neatly made. We were the odd couple. One day, Joe mentioned to me that although he had grown up Catholic, he thought I might fit in as a Unitarian Universalist. And years later, my remembering his saying that played into my checking us out. My senior year, though, Joe and I had gone our separate ways, we'd each found a different crowd. But we still kept in touch, though now there seemed to be a certain distance. I couldn't put my finger on it. Then one day, Leslie pulled me aside. "Did you know Joe is gay?" she asked. I didn't. But suddenly a few things fell into place, especially a memory from a year earlier, when one night Joe had tossed and turned in his bed and said he had something he wanted to tell me. I was tired and nearly asleep, but asked him what was on his mind. But he didn't say, and I couldn't cajole it out of him. And I fell asleep, and to my regret, I didn't follow up in the morning. I'm sure he was wrestling with coming out to me. Despite our friendship, or rather because of our friendship, he was afraid to. He was worried coming out to me would harm our friendship. He put our friendship ahead of coming out to me. Perhaps his Catholic upbringing didn't help either. Leslie, having told me Joe was gay, told Joe I knew, and next time Joe and I met up, we each let each other know we were still fond of one another. Yet that senior year, our little foursome rarely got together, each of us leading lives that were growing in increasingly separate ways. But Joe and I stayed in touch even after college. A few years later, when we had both landed in Chicago, me for work and him for chiropractic school. He'd always wanted to be a chiropractor. He'd invite me over to join him and his lover for dinner. David, his lover, introduced me to the album As Falls Wichita, So Falls Wichita Falls by Pat Metheny and Lyle Mays, which is still one of my favorites of all time. Once Joe and I went to the county fair and had a great time. And then when he and his lover fell out, Joe needed a place to stay, still going to school, starving student. And I had an extra bedroom, so he camped out with me for a year or so, each of us doing our own thing, but just comfortable with one another. As life went on, we'd occasionally touch base, and the old gang of four plus a couple others in our orbit had a reunion or two over the years. Once I lost track of Joe and had to sleuth him down. I found his sister and managed to reestablish contact with him that way. I was more careful to stay in touch after that, but still the months and the years slipped by until last year. Then Leslie called and said we needed to get with Joe. The four of us, Leslie, Lori, myself, and Joe, reunited in Chicago where he lives for a long weekend. We rented a place together and had a grand time sightseeing and catching up. Joe was still as ebullient as ever, and often I couldn't tell how far his Alzheimer's had advanced, though he was quieter. Taking us to the airport on the subway, he repeatedly asked if I'd be able to find my car once I got back to Denver. He was concerned. Joe has always had a caring heart. That Joe couldn't come out to me that night, our junior year, profoundly affected me in ways that still resonate. How difficult the realization he was gay must have been for him, especially given his Catholic upbringing, and what a solitary journey he'd had to go through. I've always wished that somehow I could have encouraged him to come out to me that night in our junior year, or even earlier. I would have been there for him. A consequence of our love for one another has been my fervent support for LGBTQ. I'll say for LGBTQ rights, but it goes so much beyond rights. Welcoming is a much better word. In my ideal world, my idea of utopia, we are all welcoming to one another. To me, welcoming means something quite different from what was once perhaps my position. I don't see X-ness. I see a person where, I see the person where X is whatever. I don't see being gay. I don't see being a person of color or trans or even, most challenging to me, of, particularly these days, of a different political persuasion. That not seeing X-ness. I wouldn't see, and not seeing the X-ness, I wouldn't see the person, really. Being welcoming means welcoming the core of one another's being, in which you do see, at least in part, the parts that being gay or a person of color or whatever means in living in our all too often biased society. Our cores are not always easy things to understand, let alone welcome. But it's always worth, I found it always worth bringing more understanding into my life and into my world, into our world. And I'm happy to say, we here at Namaqua try hard to walk our talk on this. We worked for 3 years to become designated as an LGBTQ welcoming congregation. Many of us attended workshops to increase our understanding and our ability to be welcoming. If you haven't been to one of those workshops, and especially if you joined in the last couple of years, there's a workshop Cheryl Grease and I give that's in the Adult Enrichment Catalog. Sign up in support of our culture of being more than accepting, so we can be intentional about our welcoming of one another's core being. Being a truly welcoming congregation leads to our welcoming one another's core beings in other ways too, within and outside of these walls. Race, for example. Maybe even political persuasion. Joe, I'm happy to say, is in good hands. His partner of 20 years and more will care for him. Our old gang of four will stay in touch more intentionally now, even as it becomes more difficult to do so. Joe has brought joy to many, many lives, and his life will always resonate with mine. He opened my eyes to what being welcoming really means.
Thank you to Doug, and blessings to Joe. Our offertory for this quarter, turns out it will be alternatives to violence. I mentioned last week that the Social Justice Committee was considering changing our initial plans because of acute need, and you may know that Alternatives to Violence here in Loveland provides shelter, advocacy, education, and resources for people who are impacted by domestic violence, sexual assault, and human trafficking. And in this time of greater isolation, those living with an abusive partner are at greater risk and help may be harder to find. So the agency's services now are more important than ever. They have 70% more applicants this year than the same time last year. They have filled all their available beds and now are having to rent hotel rooms for the additional people. So the Social Justice Committee voted in favor of designating Alternatives to Violence as our half plate recipient for this quarter. So they will be receiving half of our collection, and Sarah, our Zoomer, has posted the donate button, the offering giving link in your chat. And while you donate, please enjoy a song by Dar Williams called When I Was a Boy.
Forget when Peter Pan came to my house, took my hand. I said I was a boy. I'm glad he didn't check. I learned to fly, I learned to fight, I lived a whole life in one night. We saved each other's lives on the pirate deck. And I remember that night when I'm leaving a late night with some friends, and I hear somebody tell me it's not safe, someone should help me. I need to find a nice man to walk me home. When I was a boy, I scared the pants off of my mom, climbed what I could climb up. And I don't know how I survived. I guess I knew the tricks that all boys knew. She would like just a small boy on her bike, riding topless. Yeah, I never cared who saw. My neighbor came outside to say, get your shirt. I said, no way, it's the last time. I'm not breaking any law. And now I'm in this clothing store, and the signs say less is more. More that's tight means more to see. More for them, not more for me. That can't help me climb a tree in 10 seconds flat. When I was a boy, see that picture, that was me. Grass stained shirt and dusty knees. And I know things have gotta change. They got pills to sell, they got implants to put in. They got implants to remove, but I am not forgetting that I was a boy too. And like the woods where I would creep, but it's a secret I can't keep, except when I'm tired, except when I'm being caught off guard. I've had a lonesome, awful day. The conversation finds its way to catching fireflies out in the backyard. And so I tell the man I'm with about the other life I lived. And I say, now you're Top Gun, I have lost and you have won. And he says, oh no, oh no, can't you see? When I was a girl, my mom and I, we always talked. And I picked flowers everywhere that I walked. And I could always cry. Now even when I'm alone, I seldom do. Just like you.
you please join me to bless our offering. We dedicate ourselves, and these are offerings, to the vision of this congregation, which is to radiate love, peace, and justice as together we work to build beloved community. We often say that we're a come as you are congregation. And I think that people sense this is actually true. In his book called A Hidden Wholeness by Parker Palmer, it's called A Hidden Wholeness, The Journey Toward an Undivided Life. And he writes about our yearning to live undivided lives, lives that are congruent with our inner selves, so that who we are on the outside matches who we are on the inside. He describes circles of trust, a space between us that honors the soul. And here's how Parker describes the soul and how to create a space where the soul feels safe enough to come out. Quote, the soul is like a wild animal, tough, resilient, savvy, self-sufficient, and yet exceedingly shy. If we want to see a wild animal, the last thing we should do is to go crashing through the woods, shouting for the creature to come out. But if we are willing to walk quietly into the woods and sit silently for an hour or two at the base of a tree, the creature we're waiting for will emerge. And out of the corner of an eye, we will catch a glimpse of the precious wildness we see. On this National Coming Out Day, I would like us to sit quietly and see if the soul will emerge, and some of you are welcome to share your coming out stories. So if you'd like, go ahead and unmute and then feel safe enough to show us who you really are.
This is Francie, and at 70 years old, I have 50 years worth of coming out stories. And there was a point in my life living in Berkeley and teaching in the same school for many years where I felt like, okay, I've done it. I've come out. Laurel and I were on some news after our son was born, because we had used the sperm bank of Northern California and connect with them, asked for quite a few years. We were like the poster family. Moving to Colorado, all of a sudden I was in a whole new track. Amazing to me that the simple question of what brought you to Colorado was once again a coming out moment. And it's tiring to be coming out all the time. One time Laurel and I went to, for our 60th birthdays, we went to a wonderful resort in Key West, and it was a lesbian resort, and they had connections with all kinds of tourist opportunities that catered to lesbians. So everywhere we went, people just assumed we were a couple. And Laurel and I both realized separately that we are always carrying attention about being lesbians and what are people going to think. So it's lovely to be here in this congregation where everybody knows. And it's not quite Key West, but It's pretty nice.
Thanks, Francie. Hi, Nathan.
Hello. A lot of you don't know me. My name is Julie. I've been part of the Namaqua since I was 19, so that was feels like a long time ago. But I grew up in the Mormon faith, but ever since I knew what attraction was as a child, I've always liked girls. But I was taught and internalized, no matter how good I was going to hell because being a lesbian was a choice, and I had chosen sin. If I told anyone, I knew I'd be excommunicated from my community and I would lose my family. So it felt like I was living a lie and I hated myself. But after I knew I was going to graduate high school soon and I knew I couldn't hide forever and I felt like I was living a lie. So I told my parents. They refused to believe me. Yet they told all my relatives behind my back that I had chosen to be a homosexual. They made things miserable. I moved out to Loveland and I felt like I lost everyone. Thankfully to Google, I found Namaqua and made my own family. And currently I live in Idaho where homophobia is so rampant and actually even banned at my school that I'm back in the closet living a lie once again. It's not easy having to come out, but at least I don't have to feel like I live a lie.
Thanks, Julie. I'm glad that you're with us today and that you found us when you were 19. Glenda?
Hi, gang. I sure miss everybody. As many of you know, I was 49 years old before I figured it all out. And I recall that I felt like I could fly, that I felt that I was free, you know, I could take wing. And it's a wonderful joy to know who you really are and to be able to live who you really are. And I love you all dearly.
And we love you too, Glenda. Thank you. Atulia?
Hi, I'm Atulia. And I came out when I didn't come out. I had my first girlfriend when I was 19 in college. And that was quite a dramatic thing. And this was Marcy. And the dean of the school came to see me at one point. It wasn't accepted at all. Even myself, I didn't really accept it in myself. And I remember it was like a brick wall that was my construct of reality. And taking that one brick out just made all the rest of the bricks in question and the wall came down. And it was very disorienting. I remember going to my brother's military school and stayed in a hotel with my parents and just feeling like a completely new thing had happened and I was completely separate from them now. I eventually told them they didn't like it. Then I went to India for 20 years where we were celibate. Then I came back and in Glenda's group, the Backcountry Betties, I found some opportunity to be with a lesbian group. And now we're not having that. But anyway, I think at this point, I'm 70 and I might be bisexual at this point. I don't know. Because I've spent so many years being celibate. But I was very political at the beginning and went and went to consciousness raising and went to all kinds of groups and did all kinds of actions. So it was more, it was very much a part of my politics and still is. Thank you. It's thanks, nice Linda. To have a group that doesn't care.
Well, we care in a different way.
Yeah. Yeah, you're kind of on the other side. Yes.
Is there anybody else who'd like to share? Well, if not, I would like to close with my favorite coming out story. It's from PFLAG, and I've told it here before, and I carry it with me because it always kind of makes me cry in a nice way. So it's about a young man named Ben who lived in Kentucky, and he made the difficult decision to come out to his parents. But he was worried that he would be rejected and maybe they wouldn't even love him anymore if they really knew who he was. And so he asked his sister if she would tell their parents. And he was gonna come home, but he wanted her to signal whether the parents would accept him or not by what she did with the light in his bedroom window. And the arrangement was that if they no longer wanted him to come home because he was gay, that she would leave the light off in his bedroom. But if it was okay for him to come home, that she would leave the light on. So as he was driving to his parents' home, and I can sure relate to this, maybe some of you can as well, his heart was just pounding so hard in his chest because he didn't know what to expect. And so as he pulled up to the house, he saw that not only was his bedroom light on, but every single light in the house was on. And he got the message. Ben, we love you. You are welcome here. Come home. And you know, I love our vision statement that we radiate love, peace, and justice. So that's what I picture, is that when the lights are on in our sanctuary or here in our virtual community. That's our message. You are welcome. Come on. You belong. We love you. So if we were in our sanctuary, we would sing this song that we usually sing for Coming Out Day, and we sing it on Pride Sunday. It's by Holly Near. We are a gentle, angry people. So on this day, we're going to see it performed by the old Zoom choir. And what I'd like you to picture is for all of us to be together in our sanctuary, to stand up, maybe even hold hands. Maybe we could have Tim and Bob up in the chancel playing. And so, Sarah, will you go ahead and turn on We Are a Gentle Angry People by the old Zoom choir and friends.
We are gentle, angry people, and we are singing. singing for our lives. We are peaceful, loving people, and we are singing for our lives. We are peaceful, loving people, and we are singing for our lives.
To extinguish our chalice, we use these words. And so I say, ours is a story of faith and hope and love. I say it is our need for one another that binds us together.
Our need for one another brings us laughing and limping into relationships, and keeps us at it when we otherwise might despair at the fix we are in.
I say it is the holy we need, the eternal beyond our comprehension. And one place we can find it is here, working and worshiping together.
And I say there is a transcendent value worthy of our loyalty, upon which we may set our hearts, and its divine manifestation is love. Mary Oliver has a poem called The Buddha's Last Instruction. And the first line of it is, make of yourself a light, said the Buddha as he was dying. And I say to you, make of yourself a light and let that little light shine. All over the world, let that little light shine. Just a few quick announcements before we have our virtual coffee hour. One is that on Friday, you should have received our weekly email, and it had an update of our adult enrichment classes. Doug mentioned the one that he and Cheryl Grice are giving on welcoming congregation. We've had to cancel a few because the minimum numbers weren't reached, but we have a couple of ongoing classes that are going really well. And I want to encourage some of you, or as many of you as want to share your spiritual autobiography in a small group setting. So we just added that to the catalog. It will just be one session that's an excerpt from the Building Your Own Theology class. And I would give you the template so that you just kind of fill it in and then come to the group and share with us about your life. Also, next week we have the first of our series of more in-depth services about the topics of General Assembly that we came back excited about. Next Sunday it will be Francie and Worship Associate Elizabeth Fraser presenting a service called A Glimpse of the Indigenous Experience. And then finally, the following week, we'll have our traditional Dia de los Muertos, but we can't do what we usually do, which is in our sanctuary, bring up to place on the altar our pictures and mementos from people we love who have died. And so we'll do something similar to what we've done for the Flower Communion and Water Communion, which is the day before. On Saturday, it will be October 24th. Janet and I will be at the side lawn of the church with the altar built. And any of you who come are welcome then to put on the altar your photograph or your memento and share with us who that is and who they are to you. And Janet will be recording it. And then her son, Dallin, will put it together and we'll show it as part of the service on the following day. So we'll have other announcements about that, but I wanted to lift that up and for you to be thinking about whether you want to come. And so now, with no further ado, thank you all for coming. And what we'll do now is be sent to breakout rooms so that we can have a smaller group social hour.